So I want to welcome everyone to the AAG Webinar Wednesday. My name is Kim Johnson, and I'm a Solutions Manager here at AAG. And today's topic is Speed Networking, Success Stories from Event Planners. Today we're going to have a conversation with our CEO, Dan Petroski. The AAG team has been providing solutions for event planners and nonprofits for over 10 years, and we're going to share real experiences from the event floor and offer you some best practices today. So Dan, why don't we go ahead and get started?
All right. So a little bit about AAG. We provide software for planning events, for submission management, awards, abstracts, that kind of thing. We also do speed networking and mobile apps. And this gives us a really interesting platform to be able to speak from, because we go to the events and we support them for all of these products. So we have some really interesting stories we can tell. We've boiled them down to what we're going to call best practices. We save the good stuff and the best ideas, and give some ideas today on how we can avoid some of the pitfalls that we've seen in the field. So what I want to do here before we jump in is I want to have a, just make sure we're all on the same page when we talk about speed networking. I'm going to actually show a short time-lapse video from an event we did at 1871, and this is a entrepreneurial think tank or a business accelerator in Chicago, and I want to show just what an event looks like when people get together and then change. Every 8 minutes, they're getting up and they're moving around, so I'll just play a few seconds of this video. So I think you get the idea there. You see people moving around the room, and every 8 minutes they get up and they change. There's a guy ringing the bell in the background. This literally is speed networking because they're meeting people rapidly. I think this was around 900 matches in 90 minutes. So it was pretty cool. So when we talk about networking, there's various types, but we're focused today on targeted speed networking, where people get to review the profiles and choose who they're meeting with. So imagine, Kim, how would you handle 200 attendees with 30 sponsor tables, making 900 or so matches, and how would you fit that into a room with 20 tables? Can you imagine trying to do this on a spreadsheet? Can you imagine trying to do this without software?
I think it'd be very difficult without a visual of actually seeing what that room looks like and how those tables are going to fit in.
So let's take a look at some things that have been gotchas for some of our clients. What about match no-shows? I mean, everybody has a problem from time to time. They come in late or their flight is late. So out of a large room, this is a picture of, I think there was 1,000 people at this event. There's bound to be a few people that don't show. And for every person that doesn't show, that means there's somebody else sitting there left without a match. So what we do is we create something called the fishbowl, where we accommodate no-shows by putting the people left remaining at the event over to the side on some tables that we've reserved. And this way, when another person comes up, we can organically match people. So at least they have a chance of meeting someone, even if it's not their first choice, and they're not sitting there looking bored for the next 10 minutes or so.
Absolutely. As a planner, we want to make sure that everyone is taken care of, and having those additional tables allows you to recalibrate quickly so that everyone has someone to speak with during that time.
And then you end up looking like you're prepared for those things that actually were a surprise to them.
So we had a situation where at an event, they were not able to access the information online, or the attendees did not access that information. So the event planner had to very quickly print out for 200 attendees a total of 487 pages. And what we were able to experience is just how difficult it is. You know, it seems like a simple thing to do, to go ahead and print out all of those schedules, but when you look at the sheer volume and how quickly you can, you know, alphabetize them and get them distributed to the appropriate people, we were able to help a client resolve that, printing out all of the schedules and then having them on a table that was easily accessible to the attendees.
Sure. So the event planner in this case, they thought it was going to be a simple thing just to print them out and then hand them out. But they didn't realize it was 487 pages because they had so many time slots. So they ended up with a ream of paper. And while she's trying to answer questions about AV and room setups, she's trying to hand out schedules. So really think about this ahead of time, have them printed out, and then organize them on a table into two or three different piles so people can find them alphabetically and just get them taken care of themselves, and maybe have one person there to kind of monitor it. But really don't be surprised by the logistics of something as simple as handing out schedules. Networking times with conflicting session times. So this is something we saw where if a customer neglects to plan their networking and separate it from the education or the general session times, then you got this possibility of there being a conflict, and you force the attendees to have to make a choice in what they're doing. So, Kim, I think you saw where people were saying, hey, you know, it'd be great if these weren't conflicting times, but as an event, you know, support team, we don't define the times, the event planner does. So, you know, we saw people just saying, hey, this is not optimal. You know, I'm going to have to make a bad choice here, and it's hard for me to see. So I think in this case, we came up with a kind of a split screen display of letting them see their session times and their networking times side by side so they can make good choices. But keep in mind, this is a gotcha for you. So if you can, make it nice and easy for your attendees so that you don't force them into a situation where they have to make a choice, but you have non-competing times for people to pick from. And the communication gaps, this is something that happens quite often, especially if you're new to this type of event. You might send out email communications, but how often does everybody read their emails, Kim?
Exactly. You can just anticipate there being gaps of information, and you still want to make sure that all of the attendees are really supported well and taken care of. So just assume that the emails that you've sent out to them, that they've not had an opportunity to really look at them, or maybe to thoroughly look at them, and to just plan for additional ways that you can fill those gaps, whether it's push notifications, you know, obviously the signage, any handouts that's going to support them getting the information that they need so that things are going smoothly.
I've got a story I can share.
That'd be great.
We had this situation recently where a customer at 4:30, the day before the event, we ran a report and we saw that they had only one match, I think it was, either one or zero matches in the system. So we called the executive director and we said, hey, you know, there's a problem here. Your event begins tomorrow and there's no matches in the system. Can we help you to send out a push notice and tell people about it or send an email? He's like, well, we already sent an email. I don't have time to do it. Why don't you guys do it for me? Just send a push notice. So we did that. We sent one out at 4:30. And by 5 o'clock, we had 10 matches. That was 5 p.m. the day before the event. The next morning, another push we had scheduled went out at 7, and we got 18 more matches. So by the time the matching started at 9, we had 28 matches. And then another one went out at noon, which was their second matching session time. And I think it went up to like 56. So by the beginning of the second day, they had 64 matches, where just the you know, little more than 24 hours before at 5 p.m., they had, you know, zero. So if we had not noticed that and had some kind of a backup plan and recommended push notifications to remind people, that could have been a disaster where their matching would have fallen apart. So tell people, you know, create a communication plan. Tell people what you want them to do, but you're going to have to remember to tell them more than once, and then also have more than one mechanism, because email is just not enough. So here's some screenshots of some events that we've done where we've had large ballrooms. This one here on the left, I think there was 1,000 people for this one. And you see they have these tall signs and four people at a table, big matches. They meet here for several hours. And this one on the right is a smaller event, just two people at a high top. And I think it was a smaller room of like 20 tables. This one here, I think we saw this one earlier in the 1871 video. They use these longer 6-foot tables, but they had them organized 2x2. So we had to make sure that we made clear signage that showed this left one here is, you know, table whatever. I think here's the signs back here, table 19 for the left side and table 20 for the right side. This might seem like little stuff, and I do think it's things that people are easy to overlook in their planning, but it's actually pretty significant in the actual event as you go to do your layout of your room. Just the simple numbering system that you use. In this screenshot, if you look, it might be hard to tell, but they did an S pattern of the person that did the table layouts. They started at the lower left corner, and they ran 1, 2, 3 linearly down the left side, and then down the middle, and then back up the right side. Well, that was actually kind of confusing for people. So we found the next time we did the event, we changed the arrangement and the order of the tables so it was more logical and people could follow it more linearly. Again, a simple thing, something that probably wouldn't be on your checklist, but worthy of thinking through it, because a couple of minutes in a 10-minute speed networking session are going to be pretty significant, because that's going to kill your transition time. The other thing that we've noticed is that there's really an issue of, I think the bigger issue is room crowding versus a peak time for tables for everyone in the system at a peak time. So on the one hand, you want the event organizers want the event to look full and popular. But on the other hand, the realistic situation is the computer needs to know the maximum number of matches and the maximum number of tables for every match. Well, how do you accommodate for the human variable of, well, maybe people don't want to meet at 8 o'clock, so they're going to meet at 9 instead of 8. And when they have the power to choose their meetings, they're going to group them the way they like them. And you don't know what that is. So the problem is you get times of day that have very few matches and other times of day that have a huge density of matches, like we showed in that other slide. And you need to find a balance to make the event planner happy so the room looks full, and yet there's never a case where someone doesn't have a match. And this is related to this first bullet here is actually related to that problem, because we came into an event recently where the system had been programmed for 25 tables, and we walked in and there's only 16 tables present. So we're like, hey, you know, there's a little problem here, because people are walking around with schedules in their hands and in their mobile apps, and it says table 25, and there is no table 25. So it was really, we were able to accommodate it because of a report. I'm going to show this report in a minute, but because we could tell where people were situated in the room and at the tables, we could readjust and then remove some table signs. I think, Kim, you had...
Very quickly.
You were running around pulling signs off tables. So it is important to kind of think through this a little bit. We do have some best recommendations, best practices, where based on the number of attendees and the number of matches, we can say, well, we recommend this number of tables, and then we might be able to add tables later as the capacity is nearing full, because we have a way to monitor that. So we can adjust and say, okay, we're at 80% capacity, let's add 10 more tables. And then you, as the event planner, laying out your room, telling your AV people and your layout people at the hotel, you can tell them how to lay out that room with good information the day before the event. The other thing is to consider creative matching. So we have different types of matching that people want to make, and sometimes people invent their own matches on site. So at a particular event that we did in Cleveland, they had a case where typically a sponsor will purchase a table and then they'll meet with other attendees. And this goes along nice and simple and straightforward, until the event planner said, well, I've had some sponsors make requests. They want to meet with other sponsors. Well, that threw a little kink in the system, because sponsors have tables which are fixed locations. And how do you have two people with fixed locations meet with each other? Well, what we did was we just quickly reassigned them in the system to show that they could go to a new random table. But if we didn't have any free random tables available, that would have been a problem. So when you're setting out your table assignments, accommodate unusual things like no-shows and unusual match types by leaving space for a couple extra tables for those fishbowl matches, or for the unusual match types with sponsor to sponsors.
By being flexible, it gives you the freedom to really jump in and make those adjustments real time with smooth transitions.
And prevent a disaster, really.
How do you typically know that there's people who are interested in kind of an alternative type of matching? Is it they just come up and tell you, or do they somehow kind of find each other and kind of get a group of them together and let you know?
Well, we know enough now to sort of ask the customer ahead of time, what are your match scenarios? If they're using our software, we have to program in the allowed matching scenarios. in this case here with the first time this happened, it was actually ad hoc. There was no technical match in the system, but people had made requests verbally to the event organizer, and she verbally said, yes, you can do it. But then they came up to us and they were asking for where their table was, and we're like, what table? You know, you're a sponsor. You should be at your sponsor table. So we just had some extra tables and we let them sit at those tables. But if you know about it ahead of time, you can actually build it into the system. But at the very least, you can accommodate by having a few extra tables and then throw people over to those tables when some unusual situation arises. We also have group matching, which I'm going to talk about in this next slide, because we did an event recently where half of the event was one-on-one matches with just two people each, and then the other half was group matching. And the group matching and the one-on-ones used the same tables. Well, the tables only held four people. So I'll show you a visual on how we made that happen, because that was rather tricky. So this is an example of a report from our system that shows the table assignments. It's what we call our location grid view. And the vertical columns represent different times, so like 8 o'clock, and then 8:15, and 8:30, and so on. And you'll look and you'll see that there's, over on the right, you'll see there's a couple of matches, single matches, in the far right column there. But then on the left, where we got the group matching here, you can see there's seven people at one table. Now, that one table happens to be named 12-13, because in the first half of the event, it was used for single matches, where it was physically two separate tables. But then in the second half of the event, we just had the facilities people move the tables together, and then you instantly got a match for eight people, and you could support seven people or eight people at that group match for like a breakout topic. So it really, really takes some thinking and planning how you're going to use the matching, how you're going to use the room space, and what those tables can accommodate. In summary, when I wanted to just go over the things that we talked about. So one, make sure you think about your tables, how many tables you're going to need, how many matching locations, and have a backup plan. Be able to make sure you carefully consider the room, the physical space, space between tables, and the total number of people that are going to be in there.
You want to accommodate no-shows and unusual match types by having those additional tables available. Definitely arrive early and double-check the tables in the room.
Check your signs. Bring extra markers and table signs.
Absolutely. If you're not printing the signs, have additional markers and materials that you can use to create signs on site.
Graphical reports are really recommended. We have them in our system, but your vendor should be able to accommodate, or maybe you can create them with, you know, the help of some staff. But when you're under pressure, there's nothing like a graphic to show you arrangements and layouts of things so you can quickly move things around and switch things up.
You want to be careful with competing session and networking times, and it's really helpful if you can create a way of providing concurrent scheduling. This will be helpful as they are considering which sessions to attend or if they need to take a meeting at that time. And then always have a good communication plan, again, to repeat important items and to fill those gaps, assuming that they've not read all of the email notifications that you've sent, or, you know, there may be an occasion where they're trying to access Wi-Fi, there may be spotty Wi-Fi, or just some issue with their device that's not permitting them to access that information. So anything you can do to accommodate them is going to have their experience be optimal.
And I would say use more than one mode of communication. So, you know, send out a tweet, send out an email, send out a push notice, put signs in front of them as they walk in registration. You would be surprised at the silly things attendees do. So use more than one mechanism to tell them. We look forward to seeing you on another webinar.